Hey there, and welcome back to the Parkinson's Disease Education Podcast. Several people in the last couple of months have mentioned low-dose naltrexone and a desire to learn more about how this could help with managing Parkinson's disease. This episode is not going to disappoint in that light. We're going to talk about several key areas that are important to understand about low-dose naltrexone. And without further ado, I want to roll the intro so we can get right into it. Hit it. Welcome to the Parkinson's Disease Education Show, where we demystify the disease and empower you as the person with Parkinson's disease to reach your true potential. The content contained on this show is for informational purposes only and is not meant to be a replacement for information or advice that you receive from your in-person medical or therapy professionals. If you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing, and for an even more personalized experience, please ask us about our memberships. Now, without further ado, let's start the show. All right, so we're going to take this and break it into several chunks. This episode is going to cover what low-dose naltrexone is, first of all, how it might help with Parkinson's disease specifically. We're going to look a little bit at what the research says about it in light of Parkinson's disease, as well as potential considerations and cautions to consider before trying it as a treatment regimen. Finally, we're going to be talking about whether somebody should or should not consider low-dose naltrexone and who may or may not be a great candidate for it. Be sure to stick around to the end of the episode. I'll make sure that you can get your hands on a copy of a PDF, essentially a summary of what we talk about in this episode of the podcast. Okay, so what is low-dose naltrexone? So in high doses, naltrexone is actually historically been used as a way to treat opioid or other substance addiction, mainly alcohol dependence. And the reason that that is because naltrexone, biologically and chemically speaking, is an opioid receptor antagonist. So it blocks those receptors from receiving essentially stimulus from opioids. However, in low doses, naltrexone behaves differently and acts more as a way to modulate the immune system and inflammation. Inflammation is a key word there because that's something that's really important in light of Parkinson's disease, as we've discussed many, many times in episodes on the podcast and on this channel. Now, there's four key mechanisms in which low-dose naltrexone may help with Parkinson's disease. So the first of the four ways that it might help is by reduction of neuroinflammation. Microglial activation, or chronic microglial activation, tends to result in inflammation in the brain, and that's a key hallmark of Parkinson's disease. Low-dose naltrexone appears to reduce that microglial activation through what's called the TL4, or the toll-like receptor 4, which is a key player in modulating neuroinflammation. The second way is that it can help to modulate the immune system. So what it can do is it can shift from a pro-inflammatory to an anti-inflammatory activity through the cytokines. And this can actually help to reduce the autoimmune or inflammatory component of Parkinson's disease progression. As we mentioned before, Parkinson's tends to be an inflammatory process. The third is through boosting of production of endorphins and enkephalins. Essentially, what's happening is when you have this blocking of opioid receptors, it will lead the body to increase the production of those endorphins and enkephalins. The increased endorphins and enkephalins may in turn improve mood and energy and overall motivation, which are key non-motor issues with Parkinson's disease. And finally, it's hypothesized that it could be neuroprotective in protecting the dopaminergic or the dopamine-producing cells that are affected by Parkinson's disease. So before you get too excited, the claims that we just discussed are still being researched, and there hasn't been a lot of human research done with low-dose naltrexone in regards to Parkinson's quite yet. Most evidence with Parkinson's is anecdotal at this point, and other research has mainly been done in other conditions like multiple sclerosis, fibromyalgia, and Crohn's disease, for example. Those are neurodegenerative and or autoimmune. So they have some similarities in some ways to Parkinson's, even though it's not specifically the same. As I mentioned before, anecdotal evidence, there's case studies and patient reports that have showed improved mood, reduced fatigue, decreased pain, and slight motor improvements. As of where we sit right now in middle of 2025, there have been no large-scale clinical trials or randomized controlled trials, anything like that, with Parkinson's disease or individuals taking it for Parkinson's. So that's yet to come. So as I mentioned at the beginning, we're going to talk about some things to consider and some cautions or precautions before taking low-dose naltrexone. First of all, it's actually off-label. It's not an FDA-approved approach to Parkinson's at this point. Therefore, it's really considered experimental when it comes to Parkinson's disease. Another consideration is that dosing is very specific. As we mentioned earlier, high-dose naltrexone is used for opioid and other alcohol dependency or improvement of those. And so that's at least 50 milligrams. In the low dose, it needs to be between 1.5 to 4.5 milligrams in that range. Anything higher than that tends to lose the effect that's been noted in individuals with Parkinson's. Timing is another consideration. It's said that if taken at night, there's more benefit in terms of the endorphin cycles. In other words, you want to make sure that that's in sync with your circadian rhythm in order to have the most benefit. There are interactions possible as well. It shouldn't be taken alongside any kind of opioid medication as it can cause symptoms of withdrawal, especially because obviously, it makes sense. It blocks those receptors from receiving the opioid medication. So if you're on, let's say, chronic use of, I'm not saying illegal use, but maybe chronic use of opioids for pain management, you may have a problem. And the last consideration is that results may vary, essentially. Response is individualized. So some people have reported strong benefits, others minimal benefits, and some people report no change. And that's the case with a lot of the complementary things we've discussed on this podcast. So should you, shouldn't you? Obviously, I'm not going to be able to say yes or no, but to consider the proper person to do this, probably the most benefit would be in somebody who's early in their Parkinson's diagnosis and their symptoms are more prominently non-motor in nature. In other words, more fatigue, depression, pain, anxiety, etc. The motor symptoms are not necessarily going to be treated as well with this. This is also going to be best for somebody who's really seeking complementary therapies other than, let's say, levodopa or other pharmaceutical means and focusing on immune modulation or inflammation control. Obviously, lifestyle is important with when considering any kind of a complementary or alternative treatment. Even if you're taking regular Parkinson's meds, you need to be adjusting other aspects of life, not just what you're taking to manage the symptoms. But that being said, inflammation control and immune system modulation, if you're really focused on that, this could be something you want to consider. Finally, I would recommend it's best to work with a physician that's really familiar with low-dose naltrexone and interactions with other drugs, how it works, and so forth, especially somebody who's like a functional integrative physician or neuroimmune specialist, if there are any out there in your area. Basically, they could help determine if you're a candidate and to monitor the effects of it as it's prescribed, even if it's not prescribed, they can monitor your response to it if you decide to take it. Since it's off-label, it probably wouldn't be prescribed. But integrative or functional medicine practitioners would be more likely to recommend this over, let's say, a traditional neurologist. So overall, to wrap things up, low-dose naltrexone is a low-cost and relatively low-risk treatment with a potential upside in treating some of the symptoms of Parkinson's disease. Particularly, the improvements could be seen in reduction of inflammation and with some improvement of non-motor symptoms. But again, it should be remembered that this is considered still to be technically an experimental thing. So obviously it would help to have more research to validate the improvements that we may see in motor symptoms as well, or motor progression rather, as well as long-term outcomes with the use of the drug. So if you'd like a summary of what we talked about in this episode, there is a free downloadable PDF, a link to that can be found in the description where you can just sign up and get a copy of that sent directly to your email. Hope you liked this episode and found it interesting, and I hope it may be encouraging to you if you've been considering trying low-dose naltrexone or if you've heard anything positive about it and wondered if it could be for you. Thanks for sticking around to the end. I assume you liked the episode if you're still here. Please like the video if you haven't already. Please consider subscribing if you haven't. It really doesn't cost you a cent to do that, and it helps us to be able to provide more information like this to more people just like you. Please consider sharing this video also if you think it might help somebody else. Oh, I've said enough. Thanks for being here for this episode. Thanks for watching and listening. See you next time. Be empowered.